high school, you know, I was always sick. You know, it was very hard to do school when you're, you know, tired all the time. They tried diet, medications, but my kidney functions just kept getting worse. And a senior in high school is when I started on dialysis, and that was very hard for me to accept. It's very grueling, and the first time you see that thing, it's just like a monster. I had swollen up so bad with fluids that I think the first day that I was on dialysis for like 6 hours, they took like 14 pounds off of me. That was just fluid weight. Transplantation, they never heard of that. You know, I never heard of it. I had no idea what to expect.
The kidney transplant program began 40 years ago, and for those people who recall what 40 years ago was like in transplantation, that would have been 1970. And in 1970, people with chronic renal failure suffered a lot.
40 years ago, they only transplanted those people that were the best candidates. They didn't have a lot of other medical problems. They were young, they were otherwise healthy. Their only problem was that they had kidney disease.
I was fortunate. Within 3 months, I was able, you know, they called me for, you know, the transplant. So I just graduated from high school. It was June 4th, 1974.
When Viola was transplanted, it was very common for people to be in the hospital for a long time.
It was like almost 2.5 months before I could go home. And my family couldn't come and see me for at least the first 3 weeks.
Patients were told to expect me in the hospital for weeks or months at times after their transplant procedure. Now our length of stay averaged about 4 days.
Patients back then were in isolation. Their family was limited. They weren't allowed to sit, they could only lay or stand.
Around the, you know, the mid-1980s, new staff showed up, tremendous innovations occurred in transplantation, and the program has really began to really evolve and explode.
As transplant has grown, as our physicians have gained more experience, as medications have improved, we're able to transplant people who fall outside of those perfect parameters. So we see people with heart disease, we see people who previously had cancer.
The key for kidney in the future is really our goal is to get more people transplanted. There is an epidemic of chronic renal failure in the United States. And there's no question that people on dialysis don't do nearly as well as those patients who can benefit from transplantation.
Dialysis is clearly an important therapy. It can keep people alive who would otherwise die of kidney failure. But over time, it can be hard on the body, hard on the blood vessels and the heart. What studies have consistently shown is that patients who receive a kidney transplant and therefore get off dialysis can expect to live longer. They also generally report better quality of life. If you're interested in healthcare economics, it costs less to take care of people who get a kidney transplant. We encourage essentially all of our kidney transplant candidates to investigate whether there's potential living donors available.
Now, most of our kidney transplants are living donation, which means a family member or a friend or even at times strangers can donate a kidney to somebody who needs one. And we're now able to do that through minimally invasive surgery through the laparoscope. And essentially these people only need an incision in their side large enough so that we can actually remove the kidney from their body. That alone has revolutionized the entire landscape of kidney transplantation.
Our program is very strong because we have tremendous support. We have good nephrologists throughout the city and throughout the state. They make timely referrals for their patients, looking out for the best interests of their patients. It takes a lot of people to do kidney transplants. It takes surgeons and nephrologists, infectious diseases and GI folks and coordinators and mid-levels. The list just goes on, and we have all the pieces that it takes to take care of those patients.
All the pieces are in place here at Nebraska for a true transplant center, not just, you know, a physician who can manage medicines or a surgeon who can do the operation.
We're much more cutting edge.
We do blood typing compatibles, we're doing all these switches where we can have three different people who want to donate to three different family members, and they can all swap kidneys so that all these three people who ordinarily wouldn't match can all benefit from kidney transplantation.
We're doing antibody reduction for those people who have developed antibodies against foreign tissue. We transplant. If somebody's had two transplants, we'll consider them for a third.
When we've started to do more and more outreach, recognizing that we transplant patients commonly who live anywhere from 4 to 8 hours drive away, with the thought being, if we take, you know, a surgeon and a physician and a couple of nurses and do a clinic 4 or 5 hours west of Omaha, we can save a lot of people, a lot of driving, a lot of effort, provide kind of a more personable service to them, and we get good feedback every time we go and do an outreach clinic.
We've been very fortunate to recruit and retain some of the finest physicians from throughout the United States and combine them with a phenomenal staff who allows us to do the really cool stuff that I think we're here to do. At its core, we all do what we do, I think, for what's really important, and that's for our ability to take these desperately ill patients, dying patients, and give them a second chance at life.
Those transplant reunions are probably way more emotional for the staff than the patients will ever know. And when I leave from that reunion, my cup is running over. It is very exciting. The fact that she still has a functioning kidney is just, it's amazing. It's wonderful.
I've been very fortunate. I have not had any problems. Very fortunate.